Most warfare on the African continent from its earliest stages was no doubt dominated by swords, spears, bows, and arrows. Even though horses were certainly in use, especially in North African kingdoms and empires, such as Egypt. In this video, I wanted to focus on West Africa and how their acquisition of horses and guns changed the socio-political history of the entire region. What up, African world? It's Home Team here, and welcome back to another video of African history, culture, and worldview. By supporting this channel on Patreon, you're helping in the creation of these videos and supporting this content. If you'd like access to full courses and sources, or you simply want to show your support, you may do so by clicking the Patreon link in the description box below. On the African continent, especially in the open country, archers were largely seen as the superior choice to that of any other type of warrior. In fact, various African ethnic groups originating in the area we call ancient Nubia today were known worldwide for their skill as archers. Many were hired as mercenaries in Africa, such as Egypt, and other places outside of Africa, like the Middle East. And so, the bow and arrow has a very long tradition on African soil. In West Africa, the supremacy of the archer was ultimately undone with the introduction of mounted spearmen and finally, firearms. Robin Law suggests that the history of the horse in West Africa can be divided into two periods, the first being the introduction of new horse breeds, and the second being new equestrian techniques during the 14th and 15th centuries. One example of equestrian mastery comes to our attention via the Kingdom of Jolof in Senegal. Jolof horses were so well trained that they followed their owners around like dogs. The riders performed tricks and feats of equestrian skill, such as leaping on and off galloping horses and retrieving lances from the ground without dismounting, clicking their heels together from the back of a charging mount, or reaching from horseback to erase the horse's hoofprints with their shields. Beginning around the 14th century, a revolution in West African warfare began to take on a more distinct characteristic. The most obvious being larger horse breeds. Most horses imported into West Africa came from North Africa. The Bulala dynasty of Kanem used to import many horses from Egypt, and the Kingdom of Borno in northern Nigeria were importing horses from North Africa in general. Early Portuguese navigators tell us that horses were being imported across the Sahara into the Senegambia area by the 15th century. However, pinning down an exact date as to when horses came into West Africa is a very difficult task because we know that Muslim writers spoke of cavalry units within the Ghana Empire way before the 14th century. Whenever horses came into play, they no doubt became a symbol of power and prestige amongst African elites. The equestrian evolution of African warriors were perhaps further advanced by the introduction of the saddle, according to Robin Law. This introduction of the saddle and of the stirrup made possible the adoption of new cavalry techniques. Heavy cavalry tactics involving mass charges and close combat with thrusting spear and sword. With this evolution also came the adoption of better armor. And it is precisely around this period, during the reign of Sarkin Kanajeji, that iron helmets, chainmail coats, and lafitte, kilted cloth armor for horses, are to have been introduced into Kano in northern Nigeria. The adoption of heavy armor, in turn, necessitated the use of a larger and stronger breed of horses. 14th century innovations and access to better breed of horses helped to make cavalry the decisive arm of West African armies. Despite this advancement, Robin Law cautions us in making any exaggerations. Cavalry certainly did not wholly displace archers in West Africa. The two arms were rather used in combination. The attack was usually opened by the archers, the cavalry being committed only after they had disordered the enemy's ranks. Nor did the new cavalry tactics of close combat wholly displace the older use of missile weapons from horseback. Several West African people continued to employ mounted javelineers, and in rough country, light cavalry armed with javelins might still prove superior to heavy cavalry with thrusting spears. Even though cavalry was valuable in certain geographic areas, they were pretty much useless in parts of West Africa. In the more southern regions, constraints to cavalry were disease from the tsetse fly and the terrain in general. West African states in the south like Gunja and Dagumba in Ghana, along with Nupe and Oyo in Nigeria, were therefore wholly dependent on their northern Saharan neighbors for horse imports. Consistently producing larger breed horses in these southern regions was nearly impossible, and the idea of cavalry holding the same weight as it did in other parts of the world was just not a thing, because there was little to no suitable terrain, as horses needed flat and open country if they were to be truly effective. If the enemy did not oblige by standing and fighting, the cavalry could do little but go home. Despite this unequal dynamic, it still forced Southerners into wars just to finance their horses. Ironically, the thing that helped to maintain Southern state imperialism was the very thing driving instability for the region, because enslaved people were exchanged for horses, and to acquire enslaved people, you had no choice but to raid or declare war. Now, like horses, firearms were imported into West Africa. Firearms were used extensively by the Ottomans during the 16th century, and from there, they were introduced into West Africa via North Africa. Mai Idris Aluma of the Kanem Borno Empire used both muskets and Turkish musketeers in his various campaigns. In 1591, an army commissioned by Morocco, equipped with firearms, defeated the Songhai Empire, drastically changing the socio-political landscape of West Africa, leading to the growth and instability of many hybrid African kingdoms. During the 18th century, it is clear that the principal powers in the coastal areas of West Africa, such as Dahomey and Asante, rested their military power principally upon firearms. Though bows and arrows continued to be used, firearms took longer to penetrate into the hinterland, in part because coastal states such as Dahomey and Asante sought to deny potential enemies in the interior access to the new weapons. Despite the growth of firearm use in West Africa, the early muskets were frequently unreliable, limited in range and accuracy, and slow to reload. Also, training was needed to ensure troops could maintain a steady rate of fire. Dahomey and Asante are recorded to have employed the tactic of firing by ranks, known in Europe as the counter march. Firearms eventually came to dominate warfare in West Africa, especially in the 19th century. But it still didn't guarantee victory. The demand for firearms and horses unfortunately stabilized the pursuit of slaves. The greed of hybrid African kingdoms, simply trying to stay afloat against the threat of other powerful states, really destabilized West Africa greatly. All of this unfortunately being fueled by African diversity. Well, I'm all out, guys. If you like these videos and want to help in this continued production, consider supporting the home team on patreon.com. The link is in the description box below. Know thyself and remember your ancestors. Peace.